Thank you, Wayne. It's a pleasure to be here. And you know, I was thinking about how do I start off, and it was exciting spending some time with a small group of students a little while ago. I love the question of, so how do you make money in this business? And I spent my day yesterday explaining that to a Wharton professor who's my largest partner on deals, who also wrote a textbook, something or other. I don't know. He said you're only using it at the undergraduate level. I'll have to tell Peter that's a good use for it. So now Peter Wharton, Peter Linneman has been a great friend and is one of my partners on a lot of deals, and I was just with him yesterday explaining again how the real world is as opposed to the academic world, which has always been one of the fun things for me with him. So I think a few years ago we brought him down and let him explain how he saw the world, which was, again, I think he's one of the most entertaining speakers when I see him at work. You know, I thought about how to start this off, what to talk about, deal structure, all of that sort of stuff. And I said, you know, you guys probably have heard this over and over again. I think the real unique thing about the business that I'm in is that there just doesn't seem to be a straight line path to get into it, land development. Sometimes you wonder why you'd even want to be in it. My son had one of those moments the other night. In fact, he told Peter at the meeting yesterday, that in the pre-meeting, when I was asking the tough questions, he was ready to throw a bar stool at me. So I thought that was one of the greatest compliments I've ever gotten from him. So if I can click this forward. Yeah. So I took our basic, our company bio brochure, which is probably too small to read, but just kind of thought I'd hit some of the highlights and talk about my journey of from here back in the 70s. I was here a few times, a couple of times they asked me to leave because I wasn't quite cutting the mustard. So, you know, somehow I didn't take no. I came back. I finished my degree here. Even took me two times at that. I was a master's to get my thesis done. And I guess the old thing, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. You know, I can attest to that through the university. And I was fortunate. I came out of architecture school early 70s, in love with planning and architecture and, you know, all of the great things. Thought I was a pretty good designer. Thought I technically was proficient enough, but not that great to design a beam. Never really felt I had the right number that I would walk across that structure if I had designed it. And was fortunate enough, though, to have met a guy by the name of Neil Schweitzer, who was an architect who was the understudy of Frank Lloyd Wright. He had done Florida Southern College, and Neil's offered me a job, even after I was flunked by a chairman of the department here in my thesis. He still let me come to work for him. And so I moved to Orlando in Winter Park and worked for Neil's and his firm, where his concept was architecture, engineering. We had graphics people. It was very multidisciplined. Kind of new wave in those days. Firms didn't kind of collaborate under one roof. The one thing I learned there was architecture and all those disciplines are great, but they're terrible business people. I mean, the economy kept slowing down, and I kept getting promoted, and I thought, well, that's pretty cool. No increase in pay. And then, you know, finally I was out of a job. And the other thing that frustrated me was that I thought I was doing some great work. I designed a lot of master plans for communities of all different sizes. And, you know, they just didn't get built, and it was frustrating. And, you know, the CFO at the time, or de facto CFO, would say, well, but we got paid from the client, so that's, you know, what you should focus on. That doesn't quite get it. One of my clients was Weyerhaeuser Real Estate, a division of theirs over in Tampa. And they called me and said, you know, I think we could use somebody like you to help us. We'll put some of this design work in-house. And I said, but you guys are contractors. I could never sell out work for a contractor. Best decision I ever made. Especially when I called my friend who also got laid off, and I said, they just offered me more money than we were making at their old job. And a company car. So I moved over to Weyerhaeuser through Scarborough from the Tampa area. I wound up spending 15 years there. I really learned the business in terms of developing communities, residential communities, did joint ventures with some commercial developers, the Assembler Company, to name one of the larger ones, and learned more about mixed use, and really started to understand the economics behind what was driving the decision making. I would say in those days, though, I was very much about the plan, that I wanted to have my hands on designing the plan, designing the looks, even whether it was a shopping center with assemblers or whatever. You know, I was still from my architecture roots, and sometimes I just didn't get it, why people were just bored, because they wanted to know about the numbers. I was just talking to the small group, and I said, you know, one of the things I had to do the other day was tell one of my senior partners, who's also an architect, to put the drawings away, just show them the numbers first, and then we'll get to the drawings. But it really is true, and I think that in this business, you find kind of two things that drive you. One, your natural desire to make the world a better place, which in those days I felt very strong about, and also, you know, to put bread and butter food on the table, make more money. And that's a direct function of getting, you know, a deal that actually can work. So that's where I really learned my way in terms of, you know, the balance sheet of understanding debt and equity, having an opportunity to kind of work with an internal resource like Weyerhaeuser, where, you know, you didn't have to go begging to different banks, you just had to submit a process and fill in the blanks, and it was kind of like color in the numbers. It was very helpful for me, especially coming out without any real kind of structural business degree. The one thing I would say about that is you also learned a corporate environment. Somebody asked me also in the earlier session about how do you make money in this business, and I remember one year my boss showed up and he said, we're going to give you a bonus. And I said, well, that's great. And I knew what the bonus accrual was, so I kind of figured what the number was. And he said, we're going to give you a year's pay because you did this, this, and this deal. I mean, I was just flabbergasted. I found out later, once you rose in the management structure, getting a year's pay bonus was a much higher thing because they wanted to pay you less and give you more bonus sometimes, or the structure was completely different. But that was the first time that I really connected the dot, that the direct result of what you can do and make out of a project and the numbers and the bottom line should result into something in my pocket as well as the owner's pocket. And I wanted to pursue that even more, but, you know, I was just starting a family, having kids, taking a lot of risk was somewhat of a challenge for me at that point. And I didn't have a benefactor behind me where I could just, you know, like Donald Trump said, his father made a small loan for $1 million. I didn't have that. So I was given an opportunity. A. Duda & Sons was getting ready to start. They owned 100,000 acres at that time throughout Florida, and they had 40,000 along the interstate. And they were looking for someone to help them take it from entitlements, you know, to kind of a vision and put it in process. And they had hired a fellow who was in charge of the water management districts by the name of Jack Malloy. And Jack was an expert politician, even though he was never elected to office. He understood all forms of government. He understood entitlements. And so I joined them under Jack's tutelage and watched him take me through my first major DRI on 10,000 acres. Now, what was interesting for me was Jack would go to the meetings, and as I used to say, he promised the world. And I'd say, but Jack, we have to actually build those roads. It's going to cost so much. And so my job was to hold on and to kind of, you know, hold back the process enough that there was some numbers behind it and assess what the ultimate cost versus when you could recoup the revenue from selling things. It was very interesting to work at that scale. because it was a large scale. It was 10,000 acres of 38,000 acres. And we had an impact that we could have been four-laning 95 or six-laning 95, rather, for quite a while, which would have been a cost that would have just been completely, you know, impossible to absorb at an early stage. So after a few years, we were able to get some things started there, which I learned a couple of things about transactions. We did the government center building. We did public financing and learned how important it is to get, you know, people to participate, stakeholders, as I call them. Stakeholders that will come in and most of them won't write a check, but it'll be your friend and be there. And if you do well, they're willing to buy land and put up buildings for offices and health facilities and things like that. And that was a great experience for me. We went out and studied other master plan communities around the country, Irvine Ranch, and all throughout California and Texas, so it was an academic exercise. We wrote a book for ULI. It really became an educational exercise for me, as well as a way of understanding how to make a deal happen. And we did some early launch things there, such as medical office buildings. As I said, we did the government center, and things that today have been the catalyst for other things to happen. One of them early on was the Marlin Spring Training Stadium. So today it's hard to believe those bonds have been paid off, and they're working on trying to get the third team, because the Marlins left a long time ago. From there, I went on to Atlantic Gulf, who was just emerging out of bankruptcy, wanted to start a development company, and they introduced me to a partner out of Chicago who had done base closure redevelopment work and said, you know, we could go after the Orlando site and get that bid. And I looked at it, and I said, there are four other teams ahead of us, CNL, St. Joe, a lot of big names. I said, they've gobbled up most of the great talent. And he said, yeah, but the one thing that we have is we know how to do base closures, and they've never done one. And I said, that's a good point. And that's what won the day. It was great for me because, you know, we hired Chicago firms like Skidmore, Owens, and Merrill because, you know, all the local firms were either committed or not capable of undertaking such a project. I learned about things such as, you know, environmental issues, since the military would just bury anything, didn't make a difference. They operated really without any regulation. So even today, when somebody says, let's go over to Baldwin Park, I think about the bottom of the lake there and what the report showed about heavy metals. And it was the first time that we really competed, or I competed, in a public arena to get a deal, and we were one. Now, the part that I found interesting for me, it was the first time I also had two other partners that had more money in the deal than we did. And the pushback of being able to say, I'm the local guy, you guys are the out-of-towners, was my challenge. And many times that's what was winning the day, especially when we were introducing things that they didn't know anything about, such as the problems of the environmental regulation. Along the way, I get this call from a recruiter who says, I'm looking for somebody for Disney to take over Celebration. They just made the launch and they want to change the team. Got your resume and we're really interested. And I said, I don't think I'm a Disney guy. I don't think I'm ready for that kind of corporate thing. I felt Celebration was like somebody having a hobby as opposed to a real estate company. And so she said, well, I want to show your resume anyway. And she started talking me through it. She says, you have architecture degrees, but you've never been registered. I said, no, I am a registered architect. I just don't put it on the resume because it has a tendency to, you know, detract from me getting a good job. Next thing I know, I get a call from the head of Walt Disney Imagineering. He said, my resume looks like yours. I was at Reston, Virginia. I'm at Disney. oh, we really would like you to come out and talk to us. We need a real estate guy. We've got a lot of great visionary people working on the project, but things are now underway and, you know, we got to find reality and operating solutions, and yet we still have a lot of vision that needs to be perfected. After one trip out there and met him and some other people, I agreed to take that position, which I'm very glad. I look back today and I think I would have never understood the power of brand without having worked for Disney. I was just telling a little story Tuesday. Walked into one of our projects that's about to grand open. The sales associate and the model, I just introduced myself because I didn't want her to think that I was like a live customer. And she said, oh, you're Perry Greeter. She said, you know, there was a resident came in and said there's a pothole in the street. And it's funny, it looks like it's a Disney, you know, shaped Mickey Mouse head. And she said, I told him that's because we have the head of this development company used to work for Disney. So I had a hard time not even laughing. But I mean, you do something like that and it's wonderful, it's great experience, it's amazing the power of the brand. I still get that today. And I'm very proud of it, and I'm also very careful about, you know, it's been a few years since 2004. But I decided to take the job and work for Disney, and it was educational for me because I'm a real estate guy, and they had a real estate problem. And it was the biggest workout of my life. They said, look, we've promised everybody can go to the school. We've promised this, we promised that. The school says we can't put any more kids in it because it was run by the school board. You know, we got these issues, we got those issues, we got to shut down sales. I said, shut down sales? You got to be kidding me. You didn't tell me this in the interview. And when I got out to Burbank and got into the Eisner Suites, you know, they said, look, the number one thing is get us out of the newspaper. Get us out of the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times. Every time we have a negative article in Celebration, it's a hit to our stock price. And I said, this is not what I signed up for. I'm a real estate guy. So for me, this was a training in public relations, trying to maintain a real estate operation. I was very fortunate because they said, it's yours, and Disney normally doesn't do that. They'd kind of thrown up their hands. They were going to sell it and decided not to sell it, so decided to bring in someone like myself to run it. And so I recruited some PR people. I had a four-person PR staff, which is the largest PR staff I've ever had since most of the time I had zero, maybe a firm. And I spent most of my time, you know, going through training on how to address the press and handle the residents and stay out of creating more waves. And then, of course, the lawsuit started to flare up, and so I spent a lot of time in depositions and things like that, and very little time thinking about how we reposition this project when I got 1 million people a year coming through downtown just to see it without even having to advertise. So, fortunately, there were several really great people there who had, that's the other thing I think is recognizing talent. There was a lot of great talent there that was really kind of beat down because they had been there and they'd been kind of thrown under the blanket of, well, you were part of the original visionary group, and even though your bosses have all been fired, you know, you guys don't know what you're doing. Well, I found myself taking that talent and kind of re-energizing them because they really had the right answers. So in the residential area, you know, we stopped selling every home. We let the builders sell our homes. They did it much better. We charged them a larger fee than they ever thought for marketing, but we're Disney, we could do that. So all of a sudden we reduced our cost, increased our profit center. We started to introduce smaller product to get the price point down. The builders sold more of it. They started to design the product. We said that looks like something that we would never consider, so we started to design the product, and then we'd have a competition with the builders. And slowly they would say, okay, I don't really care. If I have to pay a little more to put that, and that on, and I can charge a little more, then I'll sell a lot more, and I'm happy. And we just went through the residential like crazy. The biggest problems we had were on the retail side, because we had physical assets that just didn't work. You know, we had floor plates that didn't accommodate, you know, tenants. We had venting systems and two-screen movie theaters when everybody else had six or eight. And, you know, so everything became a battle to work through, and we finally figured a way. The biggest thing we had was no commercial presence in the office market, and yet we had the most, in fact, we had the only exposure on the interstate in Osceola County. So we started office development. Actually, it was Duke Weeks in those days who did the first building with me. I had to put up the land. I don't think Disney today would have ever thought of letting anybody put the land underneath them, but that's what we got agreed to. And things started to happen. So today, you know, I'm very pleased of it. And I used to say this, and I say it today, you know, once Disney got out of the community only got better. But we had great stakeholders. We had Florida Health, who Florida Hospital put up a great hospital there. And, you know, we had things such as, you know, technology and other things that we could put money to, so that even if we really weren't state-of-the-art, we looked pretty state-of-the-art. And that was the most important thing in terms of attracting other people. I had several Microsoft executives who came in and helped me figure out how to, they wanted to start their dot-com business. Later I found out they were scooping up all the bandwidth, but, you know, we figured that out, and again, moved on. So for me, it was a chance to learn a lot about individual businesses. One that I will never be in is the restaurant business. I was in it with Disney. I sold it. And I would say I came out of that where I was an expert on how all that stuff went together and a generalist on all about it. I knew about apartment deals, but I would never know how to put an apartment deal together. But I knew an apartment deal across the street where you could look down on an active street could generate 20 to 30 cents a square foot more in rents. And so I really knew that we could take an apartment deal, but if I pushed the developer to put in higher floor plates on the first floor, I could convert those units from apartments that people were kind of nuisance apartments on the first floor to great little storefronts. And so we learned a lot of that at Disney. And a lot of that's been exported over the years. As we started to wrap up, I felt that the Disney experience had been extremely learning for me, but I still hadn't achieved, even though they had been very nice, bonuses, stock options. Stock was in the tank, so I mean, it was the options when I left weren't worth a lot. In fact, I think I framed the first one that I got because I couldn't cash it, you know, when after I left. I think I still have it. And I said, this is just not a formula. Even though I love the environment and it nurtured me and it taught me a lot, I said, it's time to turn that corner to focus on, you know, getting more rewards. I wanted that check that when I did a good job for somebody else, somebody gave me a nice big check. Those fellow who I had worked with as a colleague, Todd Mansfield, he had taken over this North Carolina company, Crosland. He was looking for someone to start his Florida operations and take over the whole land development group. They had multifamily as well as retail. And I said, those are great combinations of things. And I was able to enter that company at a level where the executives all participated in putting in funding equity into a pool that co-invested into the projects. Now, the nice part about that is it was all of some but not all of the projects, but it was across all divisions. So you wind up with a piece of shopping center and some multifamily and even my land deals. I did tell a little story about one time we were allowed to invest in one opportunity that I was the biggest lesson I ever learned of. Don't do a single investment. But as a result of that, we had some phenomenal years. We rode the market up. I had some great land transactions. We bought a lot of property in Tampa. Actually, Peter Linneman was on the board. That's the first time I met Peter. And he started a fund. We did a couple of deals with him where he was our capital partner with his fund, American Land Fund. And, you know, I was able to directly connect, you know, seeing the bottom line of what the company made to what my expectations of what I should make out of it. And that was a nice feeling. It was one that I had hoped, I wish I had gotten to it earlier. I don't think I was ready. As I said, I had kids in school and, you know, didn't come from a place where if I wasn't working, things were still going to be taken care of. So I had a lot of responsibilities. But it was a goal that I had set, and it was a nice environment. And it had enough corporate structure that, you know, we still got a paycheck every 2 weeks, and, you know, he called up the HR department, and they said, yes, don't worry, we'll take care of that insurance claim or whatever, you know. So you didn't have to kind of, you know, you still were coddled. One thing about the corporate environment is you get very used to that, all those little support systems that you learn to hate. The result is after so many years, it's kind of like, what's that, Stockholm syndrome? You know, you love it because you know that they're there. They're going to take care of you. We will have health insurance. We got to a point in 2003, even though we were well capitalized, that there just wasn't enough strength in our balance sheet to do new deals at Crosley. And so we worked with the company about a buyout. The family who owned the company, even though we had a good offer, said, you know, I think they're going to destroy the culture. They were very benevolent to us. They said, you know, you guys who run these three divisions have really made the money for us, made the, you know, you've created the assets. So we'll help you spin out to your own group if you want. So I took three other workers with me who are now my partners. And as a result of that, we started Reeder & Partners, which I was outvoted because I wanted to call it something else. And they told me I was still the old fart at the time that everybody knew my name. So that's why it's called what it is. And I started out because I was in the strongest position. You know, that I own the whole company. In fact, just within the last few weeks, I now am less than 50% owner, and I'm very proud of that. My partners have moved up, which was always one of the goals. And we were able to start a little side story about my son. He was here in college, and I was helping him, giving him addresses and people I knew to call to get a job. And one of my partners who was coming with me was going to start all of the payroll and HR and health insurance and all of that. And she wound up getting pregnant. It was a rather difficult pregnancy. She had to stop working. And so I panicked. I called my son and I said, look, I got a job for you. If you can figure out payroll, accounts payable, accounts receivable, get us health insurance and all this other stuff and put up with all of that, then I think we're willing to give you a job if you do good at that. And he took me up on my offer. And so he is a partner with us and has been there ever since we started. Fortunately, she came back to work and cleaned up the mess. Although he, if you ask him, he'll say he did a better job, but I'm really glad that she came back, and she actually is, has got quite, her, she has a degree in human resources. So she's kind of our, you might say, our mother hen to keep us comfort, because we all came from this corporate environment. So we started with that. Peter Linneman, I called him one day and said, you know, we're getting ready to leave Crosland, and so we'll be exiting the management. He said, well, who's going to manage our two assets? I said, we'd love to do it. He said, I definitely want to go with you guys. Let's work it out. Crosland was able to waive all of the conflict of interest and penalty clauses and all of that. And ultimately, we took over three projects day one that he was involved with, as well as we turned around and secured several other projects that he had money in his fund left with us to start. And that launched us. Crosland hired us as a manager, so we had some fee income. One of the things that was happening, the banks were scrambling to get people to help them with all of the stuff they were taking back. And we did a little bit of that work, and we decided that we just really didn't like it. We didn't like the way the banks The banks acted like the developers were just bad people, and they weren't. They just got caught in a bad time. We also found the banks to be very insensitive to trying to work with us or, you know, make a decision. Said that's not a good structure for us. We did a little bit of it and then quickly stopped. We're approached by several other kind of funds to do advisory work, and we decided to do that on large scale, and we still do that work today with them. So about two-thirds of our business is owner, where we have the owner, minority partner, and the operator, and about a third is business where we just get a fee income, helps pay the lights and staff and things like that. We have 10 people, we have two offices, we have three graduates, well, two on our staff, because David Arnold, I was David's mentor when he was in the program. I felt I was doing such a terrible job. I told him at the end, I said, David, I got to hire you, because I feel bad. And David has just been tremendous. He came out of a background where he was working at Blockbuster, was an undergraduate in finance, and had no real estate background. So when he came to us, he really didn't know anything about what the numbers meant. He just knew where the numbers went. And today, he actually knows what the numbers mean, and he makes us crazy because he says, I put together the pro forma based on what you guys say, but here's, after looking at the market research, the development costs, and all of this, I think it looks better if we did this, this, and this. And he is just tremendous. I can't say enough about that. And he, you know, I go to bed at night thinking, you know, I saw that entry sign. I wonder if we put a little more landscaping or we did something about that. That would be really nice. David goes to bed at night thinking, I bet you I can take that one number and make a spreadsheet that'll expand that so we can analyze it six different ways. And I'm so glad that he has that kind of wiring. I think it's so important in the firm. Just again, some of the things we've done, as I said, mixed use, celebration, great learning. Baldwin Park was the Babel Training Center. I was involved in the beginning. We did the original plan. I did the presentations to the city. And just as we were awarded it, I announced to my partners I was leaving to go to Disney. Fortunately, I was in an airplane 35,000 feet high with them, and I said, they won't kill me there. So, but they understood it. They eventually sold it to the Pritzker family, who developed it, and the lead of that group was a fellow that came out of the celebration group that I inherited. So that was David Pace. So we again continued the tradition of exporting good talent. Vieira, as I mentioned, was the A Duda project. A friend of mine is still the president over there. He said to me the other day, how come you only entitled 10,000 acres? I said, why? He said, because I'm getting beat up trying to entitle the next 5 or 10,000. I said, in those days, 10,000 acres was just more than anybody could dream, and you'd hard to believe it, but when you look at Vieira today, gee, what an accomplishment. I mean, when you look at the big box retail, the institutions, the hospitals, the stadiums, all of the public facilities, and it is the name of the game as far as anybody looking for housing in Brevard County. That's, you know, it's got to be on your radar. There really isn't anything that competes with it. So what are we doing today? A little bit of this. This is a project in Durham, right alongside the airport, that we've had with Peter for a while. It's a mixed use. We have office, retail, apartments, and we were going to do a lot of residential, and we kept finding that the market for residential as far as single family was just really challenged because Durham's school system was just so weak compared to Wake County, which is right there on its doorstep, our neighbor. So we found a group and we did a deal. We've got one of the active adult communities that's just come out of the ground, AB Homes. We sold the land to them. It was a great transaction, set a record for pricing for what we call paper lots because we just sold it to them undeveloped. They turned around and have hired us to be their horizontal developer, which was quite I'd say a compliment, but also quite good assignment for us. And it's been a great relationship. And in fact, I just met with them this week. They're extremely happy. They got 40 homes already sold. They want to take down their next phase ahead of schedule. And we're talking about diversifying the product and doing other things in there. At the same time, we're rezoning and, you know, looking at doing, how can we start the office and the retail. Another project we've got is over in Tampa, Longleaf, where we've been working at this for a while. It was a Crosland project. We bought this out of from the bank after Crosland was about to give it back, and before it did, and then brought in again our American Land Fund partners. And it's a TND type project, solely residential. Market's pretty strong. This next one on the bottom, Wildwood Springs, is 1,000 acres right near the villages, and we're just getting ready to put this into production. This is a good example of when you buy land, you like to have an equity partner. Because we bought this before the crash, and boy, everything looked great, and then the crash came down, and everybody lost their land, gave it back, and we still have this with Peter because it was all equity. We have a little bit of debt, but very marginal. And today, you know, we are the entitled piece of dirt as the villages is finishing their last phase. So we're really happy about this. It's tough on the IRR because we've held it too long. But our multiple's going to look really good because the values have finally come back. And in land, it's sometimes funny, you know, land is, everything is a different, no, it doesn't come in the same package over and over again. So we look for land capital partners who are multiple driven and not IRR driven. When we do vertical deals, we usually are IRR driven. And many times we'll partner, we'll throw the land into a vertical deal. That's fine. But on land deals, multiple driven is very important because, you know, it just may take two cycles to get through it. We always figure there's one down cycle. We hope that doesn't occur right after the launch or after we bought it. Figure if it occurs, you know, after you've kind of got your bases back to zero, it's a lot easier. But in this case, you know, it started to happen right after we entitled it. And now, you know, the villages, as I said, is out of product, so we're able to bring this thing online. We've got a lot of interest in it. We've got a great builder we're going to team with on it. So we're very excited about this one. And again, it's we've just finished putting together the land structure, which I think will produce a very nice multiple. Probably not what the original performer was, but it's going to be more than, you know, we're giving the investors back more than what they got in it. And in the land business, that's an accomplishment over a long period of time. This next project is one, it's 1,000 acres in Apex, which is right next to Cary, along the new beltway. And here we've been retained as a fee advisor. We're doing everything from planning a town center with a mall to outlet potential to how do we start residential community. And we've got challenges such as, you know, how do you, in order to flush the first toilet, we got to spend $60 million on a sewer solution. So we need public help on this. We've got a council that is sort of thinking about they should and sort of thinking they shouldn't, just went through an election. So some days it's great, some days it's not. We have, it's held in a fund that only has a certain number of years life left in it. So our owners are also challenged as to what they're gonna do. And just recently we've been able to make some big strides on public participation and also some other stakeholders. In fact, we have a major letter of intent from a national builder to start housing in there. But for us, our job is to figure out how to get it to the next step and how to solve the real big problems of how do you get $60 million to flush the first toilet. And in this case, you know, there's a solution that maybe we could flush a few with a little bit of change of this, and then we do public bond issues and things like that. So a lot of our work is showing how the path to success occurs. At the same time, We're working on the other side of the coin with mall tenants, which is rather interesting because they're closing stores. Macy just announced they're closing the store that would be closest to the site. And we want to be on Macy's radar when they decide it's time to replace that store, because we have the geographical location that meets the criteria that they have because of the roadway network. Even though the store is not ready, and it still may be years, we need to get a developer on board. We need to look like we know what we're doing, in the sense that a developer, that mall tenants, you know, want to deal with developers, not like that just do shopping centers. They want to deal with guys like Simon and people like that. And so we're in discussions with them as to how we align with a mall developer to take this interest, to make sure that we are known as the next place for the next mall, because that's where we truly unlock the value. And I'll show you one more project, and then we'll maybe talk to questions here. This is, two more. This is 100 acres in Mount Pleasant, which is a little town over the bridge from downtown Charleston. Again, we were retained by four owners who felt very frustrated that they could not make decisions and get traction with the city. We have a medical office. We just finished our second apartment deal in here. And again, our land is so precious. In fact, the early decision, they sold the medical office building and dug a, they needed a retention pond, so they dug it next to the building where the closest place to get dirt. It's also the most valuable retail land on the project. So one of our challenges is figuring out, is it cheaper to import dirt, fill a hole in, or build a parking deck or something like that and put a building on top of it? Because literally rents and values there more than will support it. It's only 100 acres, so land is extremely precious. To make it a little more complicated, we have an eagle right in the middle of the site. So we have a few people in town that think that nothing should be done ever. So we're constantly fighting a lot of political battles, but we just completed a major transaction there the other day that closed on the second phase of our office park. And again, our list of buyers is just out the door, so our problem is not what do we sell. Our problem is when and who do we sell it to, so that we still can continue to harvest the next piece and keep the maximum value going and not burn through all of our entitlements. That's most key. We have an upper limit on what we can develop here. And whether we're using that sewer for office or homes makes a big difference. And let me show you our last project here that we've got, that one we're getting ready to grand open in 2 weeks in North Carolina. It's a piece that we bought right after we exited Crosland. It was the first one we bought on our own. That we've got 1,300 units, about 400 multifamily, the rest are single family, and we're developing the first 400 lots. We have a capital partner in the development side, and we have a partner on our land side. So we have total conflict, which is also kind of interesting. In this business, you can't avoid conflict. I tell people the only way you can do it is have partners who recognize that you're entitled to make a fair profit for what you do, get paid for what you do, and if it goes better and they do well, you're entitled to do even better than the better that they did as a result of it. So waterfalls and promotes become very, very important negotiations. And this one I'm very excited about because we've already said grand opening 2 weeks, and they've already sold 20 homes in the project. So our firm, this is what we do in a nutshell today. We do selection, we make deals, we do management, and we become partners for potential certain projects. I don't think there are too many firms like us. A lot of that firms like this got wiped out in the last recession. We're small, we're nimble. It wouldn't work, I don't think, on a large scale. We're able to be 10 people that know each other. Sometimes we fight like brother and sister, and sometimes, as I say, we have no cell phone policy. Get a cell phone and get to work. That's the policy. This is kind of when we go to market, people. And most, I got a question before, where do our opportunities come from? I've been fortunate that most of the opportunities that we are working on come from things that I've done or people I've worked with in the past who picked up the phone or have continued to stay with us or helped us. And I think that's the most important takeaway. There's my good friend Peter, and as I said, it's for all of the professing he's done over the years at Wharton, it's fun to sit him, when he sat at me the other day on an asset that we don't own with him, and he said, how did I ever do this? You know, and we went through it, and kind of, everybody made the same mistake, Peter, and where you bought. So it happens in this business. I said, the good news is you have it in a fund with six other assets, and the other four, or at least four of them, are doing extremely well. These are some of the other partners and people that we work with. Wouldn't be fair for me to take all the credit. I have a great senior partner in Dean Barbary. You know, he's a Texas A&M graduate. I told him the best thing that ever did for him is let him come into the SEC. Scott runs our North Carolina operation. And of course, that face on the bottom went through this program 5 years ago. So we're really, it's fun to have him in the office, and he works directly with everybody but me generally. So, here's what I'd say is the takeaway. Make money. I know some days it's not maybe the thing that's the most popular thing, but have a path that you think this is going to make me money. And maybe it won't make me the most money today, but I can see that if I do this, I get a standing that gets me in a position to make some great money. Earlier, we were talking about how do you make money? Somebody said, and I said, well, sometimes just flipping the deal or getting paid up front. I'm not too big on it. I've made more money by bringing the deal and requiring me to have opportunities that are better than they were willing to give me if the deal went good. Now, I've also had deals, as I said, that didn't go good. Fortunately, most of them, I was an employee or I had an investment as part of a fund that, you know, was mitigated. I also feel it's really important to make some great history. It's my architectural background. You know, there isn't a project that I've ever worked on or done from the early subdivisions to celebration to what we're doing today that I just don't drive through and say, I'm glad I'm part of this. And that's part of my wiring. I just think that we have an obligation for those of us who do stuff on the land. You know, it's going to be there for a while, a long, long time. So you really are contributing to a greater part of the environment in a very direct way. Have some fun. As I said, I grew up in a corporate environment. It was fun to figure it out. I remember I came to Disney. All I did is fly back and forth to California. We had a staff meeting one day. One of the guys stood up and said, you're phenomenal. I said, where do you come off to say something? He said, you've gotten corporate to believe we know what we're doing. And I mean, in those days, it was getting a signature on the bottom of a capital request. That was their definition, and they couldn't get it. And I said, guys, you know what? It's kind of fun. They still believe that I'm their guy. I'm new. I'm in the honeymoon period. You guys have delivered a lot of success. It's like running a football team. You're making the first downs. You're doing all the work. We all agree on what needs to be done here. I'm the one flying out there, and they're allowing me, because if I'm new, to go to the higher door and open it and show them what we're doing, and you're giving me enough success that they say, keep on doing it. I had six bosses in the 6 years I was there. The best thing ever happened to me, because each time the new boss showed up, said, you're doing well, I don't know a lot about your business, just keep doing well, and if you need me, here's where I am in Burbank. Until the last boss showed up, he was somebody I actually knew, worked with for a long time, and he said to me, if you think you're leaving before you turn over the homeowners association, sell the golf courses, and sell the downtown, you're crazy. What I want to guarantee you're sticking around. So again, it was a lot of fun. I look back at those days and just say I learned a lot, had a lot of fun. And again, back to my comment about where do we get our business today, I say impress those that you meet along the way. Sometimes it's not quite the positive impression you'd like, but you'd like to think that over time it could be a positive impression. You know, I make no bones about it. You know, I was fired by the Duda Company. Times were tough. And, you know, I was hired by the Disney Company and still enjoy my relationship with the Disney executives. And, you know, it's wonderful. And, you know, I just didn't want to go to Hong Kong and fly around the country and do those kind of things. And yet the brand opens its door for a lot. And I'm also very pleased that along the way, through entitlements and political things and other sorts of things that I've sometimes had to do or wanted to do, I've met some people that have picked up the phone in the last few years and say, hey, we've got some land or we've got a situation and need your help, or even compete, like in South Carolina, against three other firms to get that project. And they say, you know, your track record shows. And the biggest thing that I add to that, when we first started, we used to stand around going, how much money you got? Where are we going to get the money? Now, we have capital providers who contact us regularly that want to team with us because we control the projects and the opportunities. We've tried to stay small. That's part of our having fun. We've tried to stay a little boutique-y because we figure that the harder projects are the ones that we can attack the best and get our most value out of. And sometimes that's not a lot of fun, but you really got to trust the people you're working with. So that's kind of my message to where we're at, and hopefully they'll pay you some good dividends. Got any questions? Yeah. Well, for me at the time, the one thing I'll take in reverse order. Wayne knows. I tried to get over here to take some courses in graduate school and said, the advisor over there said, why? You know, I mean, it was tough. I when I went to Weyerhaeuser, I had a CFO at corporate, and he literally came down and he said, okay, debits, credits, you know, balance sheet. And I go, I just don't get this work. And he literally had to take me. I mean, he said, now, you know sales and costs. Very good, because the difference, you're making a lot of money. In fact, at one point, he was explaining to me, because I had gotten to the point where I had returned all the equity. So I was actually loaning money to the other division in the company, and they were paying me interest on it. And I said, well, this sounds really good. And he said, yeah, but let me tell you about the capital call we're going to make on your company, and you're going to wind up paying us X amount of $1 million, and therefore you're going to have, you know, you're going to have debt on your balance sheet again. So, and then of course leverage again. So those are the things that I didn't know that you guys know 101. Now it's interesting looking at my son, who came through the program, and David Arnold, who came through the program, and how much better, quicker, faster they are about catching up on all of this learning curve on that. And yet, they both tell me it's so different with the land. I remember years ago, we had a session in my office where you brought down some students, we laid out a pro forma on how we look at things. Because we forecast everything out there, time, value, and money, and you know, it's you gotta guess on what this cost is and what the appreciation, and we also know when you're faking it. You know, if you tell me, hey, I'm going to increase sales by 6% and increase cost by 3%, I'm going to say you're going to make a lot of money and you're lying to me. So there's a time to know. We just did a deal where we had costs flat and actually held costs to 3% and agreed to almost a 1% increase in price because we wanted to be conservative. So knowing how to manipulate a spreadsheet to know where the design elements are that really change how the design looks. I remember one of the things I said to Ken Wong when he interviewed me, I said, you know, I've learned there's as much creativity in a spreadsheet as there is in a pencil and a piece of paper of a design. And I think that is very true. So as far as the architecture part of it, it's kind of the excitement, because I'll tell you, I find the number part of it just boring. No disrespect to my capital partners or whatever. I love it when, you know, we hit numbers or when we're above it and all of that sort of stuff. But that fades. It's a lot more exciting when I walk into a model home and I say, wow, they did a great job furnishing this. And the insides of this home reflect the outsides of the community that we set the tone for. We were trying to get them to execute within our vision. So from an architecture standpoint, I think that really helps us. The other thing is in terms of, one thing at Celebration, we quickly learned that, great, we had all these great controls. This is exactly what you do. You do this, you use these colors, you do that. After they had built kind of a little bit of it, it was boring. And I sat there with the design team and I said, this is just going to be the ugliest community in America. I said, it's going to look like, I hope nobody's from California, but so it's going to look like California where it's all that gray roof, tan, whatever. You get drunk, God knows which house you need, you know. And so from a design standpoint, that was, you know, again, knowing when to kind of change. It's fun. I love that. We sit in the session of, again, I don't get the time these days to actually design. I mostly will look at a plan or something like that or once in a while. What I really love is when we talk about theming and how much of what and whatever, because that's one thing that I think I've learned is that too much of anything is really dull. And yet sometimes when you get started, keeping it simple and doing the same thing over and over again is the most cost-effective way to get something done. And you need to be cost-effective if you're going to introduce especially a new product. So here's a non-answer or an answer, whichever way you want to see it. Okay. Well, you know, we do a lot, it depends. If you've got, I'd say, a smaller, straightforward residential deal, you know, where you're talking about maybe 100 acres and 300 or 400 lots, there still are land loans out there. We have one bank that will do 65% loan-to-value land, you know. Myself, I'm glad that, you know, they won't do any more than that because that's, when you get land values that's highly leveraged, is not good. And then they'll do, you know, 50 to 80% on the development side. And debt's good because in the development side, you know, you want to try to get it down to small chunks. So you go in, do something, and then you sell that and you move on. So debt comes in and out, and there's no penalty really for that. You just pay for the time you used it. The tough part is that, you know, big road out front that's going to serve the 1,000 units that needs a $5 million investment. And that one you either got to do with equity or you got a big enough project that somebody's willing to give you some longer debt, which is, I still haven't found much that'll work, or you get public financing through bond issues. Because bond issues come from the other aspect, you know, they don't want 10-year bonds. Maybe to take them. They prefer 20-year bonds and 30-year would be great. They'll have 10-year call provisions, but that's a different story. But as far as the money that you're going to get, it's going to be out there. And so that's the debt on the larger projects that you want to try to achieve. And whether you use, you know, the local government or some other entity that can float bonds is the best form, because that's really meant to solve the big tickets. In Florida, we saw that used for some of the lot development, which created a lot of the problems that we've worked through eventually, but that's where the CDD failed. I was the first one to do a CDD in Brevard, Orange, and Seminole counties. And every CDD bond district that I've been associated with, where we were involved in selling the bonds, never defaulted, and they're either paid off today. I never thought I'd, you know, see 20 years later, but they are paying off for 30 years. Or the ones that are still exist, like we have a few over in Tampa. The district's doing fine. The bonds are current. They've never been in default. And, you know, we had the right reserves. And we didn't overtax the homeowners with the amount that we were passing through. So we didn't burden the consumer with an amount that was, hard to swallow when things got tough. Again, I think debt's like kind of a, whether it's public debt or private debt, when it gets too high a leverage, that's like a drug you just won't, got to be really careful you don't want to take. It may feel good in the beginning, but boy, when things turn down even the slightest, it eats your lunch. Yes?
How is the broad overall like macro-level shift from, suburban residential to wanting to live in a more downtown area?
It really hasn't, because I'll tell you, the markets we're in, like Raleigh and Orlando and other, we're not in any kind of what I'd call truly secondary markets. The land got pretty well used up. Where the A and B locations, when they became soft, they quickly emerged. So you got the C and D locations, the C stuff is there. So, and the builders came back in because people like my group, we weren't in the business, so they became the developers when things came back, and they bid up land prices quite a bit. We're starting to see them exit the market in land positions, which is helping because, again, they don't like land that isn't straightforward fairway. If it's got some road issue or it's got some other issues or things like that, they don't want to be part of it. They just want land that's for their purposes, just like buying 2x4s. So they've dropped those deals, which are good for us because those are the deals we like to put our teeth into and figure out. The move inward, interestingly enough, I've seen the reverse of this in just starting, and especially in the Raleigh market that's got a very young workforce, that as that workforce starts to have children, as the millennials start to have children, boy, they sure look like a duck, walk like a duck, look like a same old baby boomer again, and I have a couple of them in my firm, and it's exactly that, we're moving out, we don't have enough square footage, there's no place for the strollers, we want a backyard. Is it a sample that's big enough to say that's a trend? I don't know, but there does seem to be, my belief is that there's an upbringing there, a cultural upbringing that's kind of restoring it, back to, it may have swung one way and now it's kind of coming back. And just like, in New York where everybody's going to Brooklyn and all of the other sort of stuff, and those areas have just kind of reemerged phenomenally. It's been the young people because they wanted the larger apartments and the space for their kids. So we're starting to see that in Raleigh. Putting your kid in your car, driving him to the school, being the soccer dad or mom, gee, all of a sudden it seems to be back in fashion. Yep. No, we rarely do a deal at 15. I'd say 20 is more the floor. They love it. We show them runs that'll bring them up to 30. We have a saying, wringing out the risk. So that has to do with a lot with the IRR. In other words, if we can say, look, we can go in and take this land down in phases or, get seller financing and do things like that, that will move the IRR faster, where a few years ago, that didn't, I don't care about any of that. I still need a 25 and a 2. Now it's like, I'd like to get a 2, but if I get a 175 and a high teen, I'd be really happy. You're telling me that we don't have this, and this risk anymore. That's coming back, as I said. And that's why we're finding more capital providers now. I'm not a fan of institutional capital providers because, again, no disrespect to one of my partners who just decided, he wanted to sell that portion of his portfolio, so now I got a new partner. Well, okay, great. Money is money. We never looked at them with that. But they came in with the story about why they're a great partner, they're involved in this type of development, blah, 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 blah. I'm not going to mention any names because they still are good people. It has just had to do with what their investors, what was good for their investors. Where generally dealing with non-institutional capital on land, I like a lot better because they're more aligned. They're not thinking IRR, they're thinking multiple. Sometimes it's tougher, especially if it's a legacy landowner, he wants your partner, you know, he may want you to hold on it longer than you want to hold on it. So I've had that situation. But, you know, development capital is better once you're ready to go. Large land positions, private equity, much better for you to go. And not funds. Because funds, like this one fund we're working for, you know, they got two more years, they just got a two-year extension. The major university endowments are in that fund. They all say, wow, it's a great project. I wish this happened 3-4 years ago. What are we going to do? So what's going to drive the decision in that fund is about what we're going to do because there's this artificial timeline in the fund about liquidation as opposed to, you know, you may be, and they'll admit, we may be forced to sell right before the value just goes up. So it's tough. Land and funds is, and that's why Peter Linneman is kind of interesting in that it's the first time I ever, he did a 13 or 14 year fund. And he has very few investors, so he has some flexibility to change the rules of how long and what, which is what you need in land. Now, I've said that. Let me tell you just one other story. I bought a site in a partner in Tampa. We're getting ready to develop it. I don't know, it's about 400 units. And it's 2005, and we have builders sending us wine baskets to get in to meetings. You know, I want the lots. They're selling wine and cheese baskets, calling me up, calling him up. And I said, I think we're going to do really well. We're going to get some great pricing on lots and all of that. And we had banks were just clamoring all over to be our lender. So everything was going as right could be. We thought that we would wind up, if we developed the property, we had rolling options on the land, we had taken down the first piece, we had plenty of time to take the next ones down, the escalators on the options were like 2 or 3%, so I mean everything, the planet's gonna line up better. And we thought we'd develop this thing out and we'd probably make $8 to $10 million. I think if I remember the number. So he and I are having dinner one night, and he said, I need to talk to you about an offer. I said, okay. He said, I have an offer. I won't mention again any names. And I think we should really consider selling this project. I said, we haven't even developed it. We just got the permits. And he said, that's why. He said, we're ready to go. They want to buy it. They'll pay us X amount of dollars. We can clear $22 million. I said, you're crazy. So he said, no, I think they're really serious. He showed me a letter of intent. It wasn't signed. I said, you know, whatever. Okay. Next day, I got a call from another builder who says, I understand you saw the letter of intent. We want that deal instead. I'm willing to pay more. I said, you guys are nuts. Bottom line, I agreed with my partner to sell it on an honorable basis to the first guy, the first offer. They closed on it. We took the money. We were 50-50 partners. Obviously, my company made $11 million. He made $11 million. I made a very nice percentage of that. Everybody was happy. And today, I still run into the guy who made the second offer, and I said, see, aren't you glad I was an honorable guy and took the first offer? So the only reason I caught that up is if you ask me in our business what's a walk-off grand slam home run, that's the example I use with my group. That's a walk-off grand slam home run. I'm assuming everybody knows what a walk-off grand slam is. Okay. So, again, thank you. It's been fun.